Returning to our four patient groups, although each group has very different needs and pose particular challenges, the lesson we learn from any one of them will often apply to the others. Taking reduced contact clinics as an example, 2020 and 2021 have posed a novel challenge to audiology: how to deliver high-quality diagnostics and hearing aid fittings while minimising the risk to clinicians and patients of transferring COVID-19. All of a sudden, our routine patients became the most complex to manage, and we've had to make fast decisions about service delivery. The main change to service delivery has been in the patient pathway. Where we used to ask routine patients to travel to our clinics for all appointments, this centralised care delivery now poses more risk to patient and clinicians than any other part of the journey. Although many will say COVID has accelerated the changes and the uptake of new tools that were already coming, such as remote fitting apps, which have helped to change patient pathways to reduce contact, along with telephone and video follow-ups. In these cases, we can't use REM, as the patient is not physically in our clinic, and manufacturer first fits are often inadequate because of the vast differences in our patient outer ear anatomy. So how do we give the best possible service? There are various methods of verification that have been applied over the years that have varying levels of objectivity and reliability, and we'll focus on just three of those methods today, though there are many more, and often we can use them alongside validation methods such as questionnaires. The first is functional gain. This is using free-field, aided pure tones to assess the output of the hearing aid. Next, aided word recognition. This is using free-field speech audiometry in order to assess the output of the hearing aid. And finally, real ear to coupler difference. The correction factor applied to a coupler response in respect to the response of the real ear. This can be measured or predicted. Functional gain. This is demonstrating the output of the hearing aid by comparing free-field pure tone audiometry with aided free-field pure tone audiometry. Functional gain in certain circumstances is actually equivalent to insertion gain, as measured by probe microphones. For linear hearing aids, the difference in accurately measured thresholds in aided and unaided presentations is the same as insertion gain. There are some benefits to using functional gain. First of all, it makes sense to lay people. It's easy to describe the difference between the aided and unaided conditions. It also directly compares these two conditions, where the hearing aid insertion is the only factor of difference. It also factors in all aspects of the hearing aid position and the acoustics of the head. There are, of course, some drawbacks. Modern hearing aids often will not process pure tones in a way that makes it easy to assess the functional gain, and so these features would have to be turned off. We're also relying on the response of the patient. There are test, retest irregularities that can cause a challenge to using functional gain. Finally, modern prescriptive targets, such as loudness normalization and loudness equalization, which also factor in speech intelligibility, will mean that you will not be able to bring aided thresholds to normal. Compression also plays a large part here. You will not be able to show compression working, and it may actually affect the entire test. Verifying by functional gain is most often used when it's requested by insurers or employers as a crude measure of hearing aid benefit. It may also be used where there are multiple clinicians involved in the patient's care, as this is quite an easy way to explain to somebody who's not involved in the fitting of hearing aids. Aided word recognition, using speech stimuli to demonstrate the benefit of hearing aids, such as AB word list or the NU6 word lists. Speech reception threshold improvements or word recognition percentage improvements will demonstrate the output of the hearing aid. There are some benefits to using aid word recognition testing. First of all, it directly deals with the concerns that most of our patients come into the clinic with. That is to say, the difficulty in understanding speech. The results are clear and understandable to these patients and to others involved in their care. Because of the stimuli used, we can also verify the different hearing aid features and leave those switched on in the hearing aid. However, calibration and consistency across testing can be a large challenge. Using calibrated speech stimuli from your hard drive is a way of dealing with this, and phonetic scoring will help to decide how to alter hearing aid settings, but this is still a challenge. Again, we're also relying on the patient's response, and retest irregularities will cause a challenge. There's also a short presentation length of the stimulus. Therefore, some hearing aids will not recognise the stimulus as speech unless there is a significant preconditioning signal that's given. Again, this method is particularly useful for patients that have multiple clinicians involved in their care. It's also useful for patients that have different requirements set by their insurance or employers. It is also useful for patients who are poorly motivated or who have family that are difficult or poorly motivated themselves. And finally, the real ear to coupler difference. The real ear to coupler difference is a correction factor applied to the coupler response in respect to the real ear response. There are, of course, some benefits to using the real ear to coupler difference. First of all, it takes the real ear into account. The acoustics and the challenges posed by different anatomy will be factored in. For most of the process, you don't actually need the patient in the room with you. So those that are difficult or will not tolerate the situation can actually leave your clinic. You can also verify multiple features of the hearing aid, not just the frequency output. You can measure the RECD, or you can use predicted RECDs based on normative values. As ever, there are some challenges to using the RECD. First of all, placing the probe mic. Different probe mic placements will have a large effect on the quality of the RECD measurement. Venting effects will also play a large part as to the quality of the RECD measurement. Different techniques that are used by different clinicians will also introduce different levels of error. Different errors are also introduced by transducers that are selected, and so this must be taken into account. So for the RECD, how do you ensure the maximum quality, and what factors do you need to take into account when performing the RECD? First of all, the prescription formula that you have chosen. This is, of course, dependent on your fitting goal, but it also should be considered if you're using predicted values, as different fitting formulae have different normative values. Next, the transducer selection. Supraoral headphones may induce additional errors due to the way it sits differently on patient heads. This difference is not enough to change PTA thresholds, but it can cause large differences in measured hearing aid response. Insert headphones are recommended for testing patients where you intend to use RECD for hearing aid fittings. However, if you only have PTA measured by supraoral headphones, you can still use them for an RECD. The acoustic coupling. If you have the patient's ear mold, then it's recommended to use this for the ear portion of the RECD measurement. This isn't always the case, however, especially for populations we're discussing today. For these, insert tips or the SPL60 probe are recommended. We will discuss the SPL60 probe a little bit later. Venting considerations. You must plug the mold's vent at the medial end to avoid the vent causing negative RECD in the low frequencies. The coupler measurement is closed, and therefore we need to ensure the patient's ear canal is also closed. Slit vents caused by mold fitting can induce some errors and should be looked out for. If you want to verify open fittings via RECD, then it's recommended to not use the patient's mold or dome, but an alternative method like the insert tip or SPL probe. You should only focus on frequencies above 1 kHz, as these are not affected by venting. Probe mic placement. The distance of the probe microphone from the eardrum and beyond the sound outlet of the stimulus delivery method can have a large effect on the accuracy of the RECD measurement. For most of the population groups we've discussed today, this is the main factor that causes poor RECD measurements. Despite the many challenges posed by RECD measurements, when performed accurately, this method is the best alternative to in-situ real ear measurements for its breadth and depth of application. Many of the challenges are suitably overcome by the use of the SPL60 probe, as it uses a rigid probe to guide both stimulus delivery and probe microphone into the ear, fixated by a standard TIMP tip. What follows is a video from my colleague Lee Martin explaining how to use the SPL60 Pro.
This quick guide video shows how to perform an RECD using the SPL60 probe on the Affinity Compact. The SPL60 probe provides a clinical alternative to measuring the RECD using the patient's own ear mold. This is particularly useful if the ear mold is not available or if the RECD with the traditional method is difficult. In order to make an RECD, it is essential to select a protocol which includes the RECD test. Use the drop-down list to select such a protocol. The SPL60 probe combines the stimulus tube and the microphone tube into a single unit. This is then connected to the headset as shown here. Once connected, a calibration of the SPL60 probe is required. This is performed by firstly pressing the tube calibration button and then select SPL probe. Follow the on-screen instructions by aligning the tip of the SPL probe with the reference microphone and then presenting the calibration stimulus. We are now ready to take a measurement. With the RECD test selected, click the start button. An instructional prompt will inform you of the next step, which is to place the SPL60 probe into an SPL60 adapter and a 2cc or 0.4cc coupler. Then we measure the coupler response. The frequency of the coupler is now shown on screen. The next measurement is the real ear measurement. Select an appropriate tip and attach this to the SPL60 probe. Note that the SPL60 probe uses the same tips as standard tympanometry. The real ear response is now measured and automatically subtracted from the coupler response. This leaves the RECD and can be seen at the bottom of the screen. You are now ready to fit the instrument by placing it in the test box and performing a real ear-aided response measurement. It is important to note that when fitting an RECD measurement using the SPL60 probe, the aided measurements in the test box must be recorded using a HA1 adapter connected to either a 2cc or 0.4cc coupler. Thank you for watching this video. To learn more about the Affinity Compact, please watch the following videos. Alternatively, contact your local Interacoustics support representative.